Joyce Joseph. Machine awa ndamba puzzle kwa MCV. Ndiyala ndono jindu kubanga bwino. Kanamba ndipasala wansi. Awa ndipasala wansi. Ndoneweza tiina ama ndisungira. Ama ndisungira. Akuma ndisungira ndana ndipasamakina. Udi ndisungira kwa nyumba. Ndote ayo ama tinga ako ndame. Mina ama ndisungira ayo. Ndinayamba pa 14 September 2014. Azi bwino fuka ndikupita pasogolo ndinakhale ndikungokhala kunyumba sibwezi ndikuphuza nawo luso limenelo koma panopa ndimayamika kuti ndili kumene koko ndipo akutiphuzisa luso labwino ndikuona sogolo langa kuti litha kupitilira ndi ntchito imene ndikuphuzirayi kusiyana ndikuti ndinakangokhalapo kumangolemba mayeso a folo kungokhalapa khoma zomwe sizinakana ndithandiza ndipo ndetu kwayamika kwambiri futi Siti maziyo utanga tipangile zimezo, ndipo ndizo sanga asa umbili. Kwa pili tima umeneo, asasika. Mene feti na shoka, ena mena zizatu wa mena kubwela mbuyo. Kuta aza pangila suziti, aza pangila zimezo.
Jine Yusuf Joni. Ina joina 2005. Ya, kumena yambo kupuzi la pa MCV. Ya, 2005. Ya naziganiza sogolo kuti ndingapange bwanji zamazi palibe zvomwe zvingandithandize nde palibwe kuti ndipeze njito yamanja yomwe ingandithandize ya pamene naye upuze naone kuzinda zinthu zambiri wambiri ya kuti zomwe ndikaganize kuti ndingaziveze ne kuma ndaziveze chifukwa kuchoka pa MCV upuze napuze kenaka pazi kumayamba kuma ndilipira pang'ono pang'ono ndibaze naone kuti bola ndipange ulendo kuti mwina mwake ndikagulira njito kutali ndipamene napita kutali nayenda ulendo woyamba basi nangobwera basi nde napitaso basi kachikuli basi nagula malo ano basi kena kuyamba kuyamba nyumba basi kena koso namangazi nyumba kukuyandwa nambala 4 kena koso nagula ng'ombe zinthu zambiri zokuti naonakuzinda tomwe ndimasoka zikwama kuti zikwama zene zilikati kuti mwina mwake ndingakuonesene ayi kwauza kwakekwa kuti talimbikire aphunzire njito ya manja yamathandizo kwambiri chepoko munthu kugula njito pa tipanamatiya mmazi zimathandiza koma kugula kupuzira njito ya manja amakhala bwino kwambiri
azina anga ndina Isaac namba zaka zimene meza pitazi kusinthe ndiye kulipo afuna ndikukwanisa zimene sindimathe kukwanisa kudula ndekha shati chija kusokaso ndekha tirauza chimozimozinso machina anachita kuti bwelekatu kuti zithandizika samaso ye ndiwo pakomo pano okay mawu anga ndiwoti ungothokoza kuti asasiya kwapangira ena mtima umene wabwino
ine nawo mihali ine nandisangala kwambiri poona kuti mwananga amangoyendenda mune siku ataisiya basi so chithandizo ndi ana amtenga mu CV kuti akapweze kusoka ine ndadosangala mumtima mwanga iya zokupindula ndeso ndiosangalala poti mu CV ampisa mwana wanga ndipo wachita bwino
inanga ndi ali nemba kupezera pa 14 September 2015 alhamdulillah panopa zina ndikutolera ndikuti ndikungothokoza kuti mulongo sogolo langa atayika pasogolo ndithu ndimakwanisa kusoka trauza magwanda mashati ndizina zatena mangazi kwamba ndimakwanisa kusoka zikupindula chifukwa panopeta kuchena ndizina chifukwa yake ndikutolera yao pomwe nganaso ananithandiza kutolera kuja ublanket ndiyo ndikungowayamika kuti ya sogola langa mwina wake ndidi pasogola ndithu
dzina langa ndine Jamila Hassan pa MCV nayamba chake cha pa 28 April 2014 panopa moti ndili ndi zaka ziwiri ndi hafu ndikuziwa zambiri moti zina ndikuziwa ndithu panopa
chimene munganena kuti ichi ndimadziwa kusoka ndichani
ndi masoka magwanda ama dress mina national wear ndi masoka zambili ndithu bwino ulipo kwa basi modi ubwino wake ndi kulize bwino zabwino modi nenda puzirapo kusoka chani zambi si kusoka koka ndapuzira ko zambili kumeneko ndikutendiza kwa basi ndipo pindu lilipo ndipo zikupindula so kwa basi umoyo wantu kwana chifuwa cha kusoka kwete panopanda biza blanketi loshokela kumwa kumwego kwa mazati ndagula ineyo zovala ndivu zigulila bandika chokuja chimene pakhomo ndi mapanga ndithu china kayashani chofuna cha moyo wanga ndi magulu loshokela ku ndalama yakuti yakuye MCV
zinanga ndi Julius Kamwendo MCV na joina September 2013. Hapa ana sininga nami kuyenda ndezi kuyenda kwambili chifukwa kupindula ati kupindula. Monga majimozi jijo ndi machini wa. Tinapindula komaso ama debasa kandala mapangono kuti tizithandizika ndithu kuti imatikwanira kwa ifeyo. Komaso hi ana madigulia ma blanket dizina zambili monga tikadwala madipitisa kuchipatala ndi timaendera so njinga zisulo zina zizosa magulira ndiyo ndito mawu anga ndiyakuti amene akuti thandizawo asasiye kuthandiza olo ine ndikazachoka naso azathandiza chimozimozi ngati mena ndithandizira ine fuwa ndikuona kuti moyo wanga watukuka ndikuziwa kupeza ndalama pandekha kwaza kuziyimiraso pandekha ndiponso mapulani anga ali pakuya kwambiri chifukwa choti ndaziwa ntchitoyi nde asasiye kuwathandiza ena amene azabwera mbuyo komanso ine ziwo kwathokoza kuti ziko mwambiri atithandiza kuziwa ntchitoyi
sedija 2015 avule zambia ziwasende imonga pakugona nyumba imonga dongosa chakudya akapena kwa mwa matelenezi kuti tizipanga tandizira mmuzimu Tiziweza tandezi. Vanga dress, skirt, ma blouse, ni mapanga. Ndiyo mene ni mapita wamene wawo. Ndiyo ngo sara nani pangi lote. Tiziweza malo wako.
Sia uli ya mama nitandiza mpaka nalilo wako nitandiza. Tu, sijukulu janga jimene cho. Pano takalamba, ndilibe nshizo, ndilibe cho yenda yenda balibe.
He lost his both parents. He didn't have parents. He was used to be with his grandma, and when he came, we tried to train him. Then he came to a certain part that he was my deputy in that project. Yeah, I'm impressed because our aim as a sewing project is to train the kids, and at the end of the training, we need them to be self-reliant. So as a school, we have to produce and send them out for their own businesses. So as of him, as of now, I can say it's a great achievement for him because I can see there are some things that he did in South Africa that he couldn't manage to do while he would be with us at MCV.
Everything he's doing for himself, he's managed to doing everything well himself, like a tailor, you know, yeah.
Oh, my name is Abia Ayami. Yeah.
Abia Ayami, you are the manager for Nettie Sewing Project. And how long have you been with the project so far?
Yeah, I have been with the project for 11 years. I joined the project in 2005. And during the first time, I wasn't a manager. I was just a teacher. But after 2-3 years, I was promoted to become a manager in the project.
All right. Yeah. So would you tell us what are some of the things that Nettie Sewing Project do people would like to know?
Most of our first priority is to train the young teenagers so that they can become self-reliant in their future. And in the program, we provide some quite few number of items. For example, we provide them lunches. During the lunches and the transport allowances and even medical assistance, and also during the hard time, for example, last year and this year, we managed to provide them 3 bags of maize during those 3 months of hard time. Yeah.
All right. So far, we have actually gone through so many places, and we have seen that you are into an outreach program where you are giving poor people something. Would you tell us why did you decide to do that?
Yeah, sometimes we decided to do that, those things, because when we see that we have some of our friends that are really need to be helped, we think it's wise to help them. That's why we do that, those things. But our priority is to train those teenagers, but we don't just stop from there when we see that this one supposed to be given a food. When we have money, we have to provide those things.
Okay, so yourself, the moment you were actually joining Nettie's Sewing Project, did you know anything, or it's just that you learnt from that same project? Did you know anything?
Yeah, I was already a tailor, but I have been doing some training inductions with the project. Mom Nettie used to send me to Blanta to exclusive fashion to see how I can improve the quality control in our program. Yes.
All right. So the people that you say you enroll at Nettie's Sewing Project, after they finish the training, where else do they go? Do you employ them, or they go somewhere where they can work?
Yeah, as I said, that it's a training program. It's like a school. We have to enroll, and we are supposed to have some that are going out. So there are some we used to keep so that they can help us doing production, and there are some we used to give them machines. During the first time, we were just giving them the machine for free, but as of now, they are buying it through their allowances. We are giving them part of the allowances, and the 10% of allowances we used to keep, and we can borrow them the machines, and after quite some time we can see that in terms of the allowance that we have been deducting from their allowances, how much then we can give them for machines.
All right. Yes. So at the end of the course, because I understand this is a course, at the end of it, how much do they pay? Each and every student that is learning at Nettie's Sewing Project, do they pay anything, or it's just for free, a charitable organization?
They don't pay anything. It's a free training program. Yes.
All right. Yeah. So how far do you think you want to take this one? Because I'm sure there are a lot of youths here that are just staying idle. Do you think you're having that, idea of taking others, or the number that you have here, that's the very same number you continue having?
Yeah, we want to continue doing the same work we are doing with the community, but we don't want to go further to as a big number. We were thinking that maybe we have to have a number of less than 20 students in our program.
So since you said they don't pay anything, what's your benefit that you're teaching them? Do you intend to benefit anything?
Yes, we benefit, because as you have seen in the villages, you can see that we are trying to change their lives from hard times to a better life. Mm. Also, I wanted maybe to thank the Mom Nettie for having those ideas to come and introduce that program here, because it has helped in our villages, and also even I myself, when I joined the project, I wasn't like the way I am right now. I'm coming from the poor family, whereby on that time I didn't have a nice house also, but I managed to build a better house in 2000, and I started that house in 2007, and I finished 2010 for 3 years. Then I rented the house, the big house, and also then I started saving so that I can build another house, so that I can start being in that house. And in 2013, I finished that house, and then I moved from the grass house to iron sheets house. And then from 2014 up to this year, I managed also to build my mom's house. That's also my great achievement. Yes.
So you mean what we are able to see here are your houses?
Yeah, those are my houses. Yes.
That means you do they do rent as well. So
yeah.
Some people.
Yes, I do rent, and the on part of that, I want also to thank Nettie for trying to help me to give me some bonuses, because I'm getting enough salary in comparing to the other people, and but according to the responsibility that I have from my family, I have to help them, the other people. And sometimes Nate just come and say, okay, I'm giving you this bonus so that you can do whatever you want. And that part also, that chances, I utilize that chances to do the project. For example, the first house, during the first, in 2010, it was just a plastered and no kitchen and no painting. She gave me that opportunity to use the money and the paint them everything and pay the electricity. And even this year, or the other house also, there is somebody else who gave me the bonus. That was the $400 in 2012. And also that $400 helped me also to finish the other house. And even this year when she came also, she found that the I worked hard, and then she said, okay, I want to give you $100,000. Then I went right to buy the cement and finish my mom's house, so that maybe she can be also in a comfortable house.
Nettie Graulich.
Yeah. So you are the founder of Nettie's Sewing Project. When was it founded?
In 2002, I came for the first time, and we were just training women how to make clothes, to learn to sew by making clothing for the kids to go to school, because I had found out kids couldn't go to school if they didn't have a shirt to wear. So I said, okay, that's what I'm going to do, and got the idea that I had to create jobs for the people if I was going to teach them. And the result is that I have been coming for 15 years, and so now we have a training program and a production team whereby, you know, so many people are employed, and they are with us at least 2-3 years. They're all teenagers who haven't had a chance to go to school, and after they have graduated here, many are going to South Africa, because there is a lot of job opportunities for them. In Malawi, it's very difficult to make enough money to take care of a family. And this is what our kids are learning as they are here. They're not just learning how to sew, but we also teach them how to be good, caring citizens and all that. And one part of that is you're not just responsible for yourself, but for your immediate family. It's the difference between the world here in Malawi and the world where I am coming from. So all these kids who are working here now are taking care of their immediate families, but also the kids who have gone, and you have been to the villages with us yesterday. You have seen that all these kids, it's a track record that I'm so proud of, because it's so successful that they are keeping on taking care of their families here.
All right, so you said after maybe some of them have learnt here, you've actually taught them how to do everything, and at the end of all, they go to South Africa. Don't you think it's bad? Because I thought if you teach them here, they have to serve the community here. Don't you think it's too bad for them to go to South Africa where they can serve other people?
No, it's not bad. It's the only alternative we have for the kids to make enough money to take care of their families here. Because of all the clothing that ends up from America, Australia, Europe, it ends up here in the markets, and it can be bought for very low prices, so people can be dressed. There is not enough work for tailors anymore. Yes, all our kids have a machine in the village so that they can do what we call freelance. And they do nicely on that on the weekends and in the evenings when you're home. But it would not be enough to have a good, decent living for themselves and families. So in order to make the money, that's what we have to do, to have to let them go. Not all do. There are also some of them who make it here and just do fine. But the competition would be too big, you know, to really actually make a good living. And that's what it's all about. It's not that we encourage them or want them to. It's what we have no alternative. And thank goodness, so far, the alternative is there.
All right. So I have actually seen that you do some outreach programs as well, whereby you did distribute some meals to the less privileged. Is this part of the project?
It has become part of the project. For me, it is when I take these kids in, they are our family. They are our responsibility. And the program keeps going all year, even when I'm not here. I come here for 3 months during this time of year, but the program keeps going because I have a manager who has grown up in this project, and he has been here for 11 years, has learned to be a teacher, a manager, you know, a sales representative, whatever it is. So I'm very lucky to have that kind of a person that keeps our goal. We know all year long what's going on, and so when we find out there is drought, we cannot have anybody in our project or their families go hungry. That's how we feel. So when we heard this year about, when I heard also about the drought, and so many people around the world heard about that, people said, Nettie, what can we do for you to help you out? And I said, I need money to buy maize. And so we have bought lots of maize so that we have enough maize now, and we have started already last October when the problem started, right through April next year, when hopefully there is a new harvest. So all our kids, not just our kids, but their immediate families will have food. It's not just food, shelter. It's very important that you have a roof over your head. So if we find out the roofs are leaking, we repair the roofs. If you don't have a place to stay, half of these kids are real orphans. They have no father or mother, and they have not real. We build a house with them. It's not just a gift. They work here every day from 7 to 5 during training and after work. And we are producing a lot of things, and we're selling those things, so making money on that. So they get wages for that. Because they are so dedicated and doing a good job, we call that their bonus. The houses, the roofs, the food, and all that kind of thing. So it came all along as we were running our program that we said, this is how we're going to do it. It's very important for us that you are all taken care of. And you can see the smiling faces here, right? Everybody's very happy.
All right, so another thing that I've observed is that apart from teaching them here, I have seen that in most of the places that we have actually visited so far, you are teaching them how to plant trees and, you know, water them. I mean, what's the connection between the sowing project and tree planting?
Oh, how sweet of you to to see that. Because, yes, what does that have to do with the sowing project? I go to the villages, you know, to see how the families are doing. And so last year I said to Ayami, I said, there are no trees, it is terrible, it's all dust, nothing growing. Now, around here, our sewing project, in 2008, when we built this building, I said we need shade, and if we have shade, we're going to have food at the same time. So we planted mango trees. They are full-grown trees now who give a lot of food, mangoes, every year. So I said, how about all the kids have to dig a big hole, you know, 3 by 3 by 3, that's a, put manure in, have it ready, and when the rains are coming, they all get a mango tree, a grafted mango tree that we buy for them. It's less than $1 to buy a grafted mango tree. And they have to take care of that. Now, it's easy to say in this country, you can't just put it in the ground and have it grown. You have to water it to make sure. And you have to put a barricade around it because the goats love the leaves and you're going to eat it before it gets a chance to grow. So they had to make sure that all that they would do, and then they all got a mango. Now I'm so proud of them because all the mango trees we have planted last year are growing, as you could see yesterday. Thank you for bringing that up. One of them was a casualty of a burning, because you know the people burn their dry grasses here, and so she felt very sorry about that, Jamira, but yeah, that happened. So this year we're going to do another tree. You have also seen then the rocket stove.
Yeah, that's what I'm about to ask.
What does that have to do with the sewing project? I heard about a rocket stove, and a rocket stove is a very simple stove you can build yourself. All the people cook here on three stones. That's what they have done for years and years and years. But a rocket stove is made out of stones and mud. In this case, we don't even need cement. And because of it's like a little funnel, you use a lot less firewood. Now, firewood is a commodity that's very hard to get, and it's expensive. So I said, how about if we make some rocket stoves here? Ayami, make a sample for us here so the kids can see it. So when I came now, we did the demonstration. This is how you build a rocket stove. You all go home and build a rocket stove. It is all to make life better for them and their families. So it has nothing to do with sewing, but that's why this is not just a sewing program. This is an all-around program of what can we do to have a better life. So that's how these things came up. So I don't know what I come up with next year, but this has certainly worked. You saw the rocket stoves at work when we were there. They were still hot from that they had been using them today. And yes, they agree. It uses less firewood. So yes, that's what it's about.
Okay, so you've been a professor in the university, I understand, for some quite a long time. For how many years?
33 years in Marymount University in Washington, D.C., yes.
So why did you leave all that? I mean, that was a high-paid job, I understand, and you left that one coming here. I mean,
never left it for a long time, not until last year that I actually totally stopped teaching there. No, I could do that job and I could come here during the summer months because as at university you have a long time. But I wanted a full 3 months to be here, and also I want to visit my family in Holland still and all that. And I'm way past retirement age, so I thought it was time to do the things that I really wanted to do. And it was then a decision, do I keep on teaching, which I could have, or my project here. My project here is my passion. This is what I want to do, and as long as I can. So as long as I can, I will be coming here every year and run this program.
Don't you think going back to Holland, leaving everything here, don't you think you could complicate matters as far as whatever is happening here is concerned?
Oh, very much so. Yes. Thank goodness that is not a concern at all anymore. As I said, Ayami, and you will be interviewing him. Ayami, 11 years with the program, came in as a poor boy from the village, just like our kids are when they come here. But he had learned tailoring from his uncle. And I needed somebody to teach the kids that came for new training. Ayami has grown up in this program, is totally capable, and he is now the boss. I tell him, you are the boss, I'm just a visitor right now. Because he can learn the whole program, we're on the phone, we're on the internet, he can make all the decisions, he can do all the accounting, absolutely, totally. The kids look at him like their older brother. They respect him very much because he is very a gentle, good person who knows how to deal with everything. If there is a problem, he can solve it together with the direction here of MCV. They help out. We have total cooperation there because they know our program and how well we are running this. So I never have any problem while I'm gone. It runs as strongly as I'm here. I just come with a lot of new ideas to make things and all that, and we discuss all our options that we have. But otherwise, total, yes, and that is a very lucky thing. I am very grateful for that.
So do you believe that everything is actually going on smoothly, or you do have some challenges that you face here?
Yes, it's going on smoothly. It's one of my former students who was with me the first year, Veronica, walked in one day and said, Nettie, your dream has come true. And indeed it has. I mean, when I look at my notes from the first year I was here, I sort of envisioned something like this. But it takes years to accomplish, which we now have. So after 15 years, yes, if you see our operation here, anybody who walks in said, how have you done this? Well, I ask myself, how have I done this? It's fantastic. So yes, there are times that things are very smoothly and you're running the wave up. Then there are challenges in the country that we cannot control. There is no fabric available. Then those times, what are we going to do? Because now, you know, we cannot produce as much as we need and all that. Okay, then fuel comes in the country, things start getting easier. Now, the big problem is electricity. The power is out all the time. We had some days a week ago, 3 days in a row, no electricity. It would only go on at night so that people's food wouldn't, you know, spoil in freezers or what. But no electricity. No electricity means we have to do everything on the treadle machine. Because of the kind of quality of work that we do, we cannot do everything on the treadle machines, and we cannot do any overlocking, which is finishing off on the inside. So we've looked into a generator for ourselves. Too expensive, only runs 3 machines, would still not work. So now we have made an arrangement with here MCV. They have a big generator, and as we speak, right now everybody is working because we buy the diesel and we're running the big generator from MCV so that we can continue doing our work again. This is not a challenge that's just only going to be here a couple of days, couple of weeks. This, as long as the drought is there, since it's hydroelectric power that is being generated, it's going to be a big problem. So not until the rainy season will we know if this will sometime stop. Yes, so challenges all the time. But that's running a business. That is a normal thing in life that happens like that.
All right. So what's the competition like? How is the competition on the market? Because I understand you said yesterday that, you know, due to the coming of some of the people that are selling clothes at the market, this has actually brought problems as well here. Could you elaborate more on that one?
Yes. So we do not just have customers coming in and we make clothes for them. We have Club Makokola, which is Makokola Resort is called. No, Club Makokola, whatever. Makokola is a big resort nearby. And we have started working for them, I think, 4 years ago. They have lots of employees. For all the employees, we make all the clothing. So it is work suit, it's overall, it's cook's clothes, it's the office uniforms, everything we make. So that is our biggest customer for that kind of an income from which we make our wages. And then we have all these items that we make that we call our craft items that we sell to visitors who come to this country. But also Club Makokola has 3 stores, the 3 biggest stores that sort of cater to visitors and foreigners who work in this country. And they buy all these items and sell them very, very well. So that's how the income for our project is going. So it's not just individual making clothes for people, because the kids do that at home as freelance. Yeah. That's how they do.
So lastly, what new ideas I actually bring to Nettie's sewing project? Maybe you might have some other ideas and the vision as well. Would you tell us?
My vision has come true. And that vision is to run a program like this. I never want more than the 20 people that we have, so it can be managed easily by one person and another teacher, and then very good tailors that we have trained. And that way it can going on forever. Now, if I wouldn't come anymore with the extra money of donations, like the for to buy the maize, to build the houses and all that, we still know we can run a training and we can pay a very good wage compared to the rest of the country. We pay a very good wage to our kids. We can do that. We can make that money. For the extra, yes, it has to come from the outside. And that's why I take a lot of these things home. There are other people that are very nice. They take things home and sell so that we have extra money. If there is a drought, something like that, for the maize, it has to come from donations.